Good evening. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Manu Bhagavan. I'm a professor of history and the chair of Hunter's Human Rights Program. It is my pleasure and honor to welcome you here tonight to Roosevelt House for a very special conversation with the Honorable Senator George Mitchell. Roosevelt House, as some of you may know, is the former home of Franklin and Eleanor, a gift from Franklin's mother, Sarah, who decided that she loved her children and this house so much that she decided to move in as well. It was in this home that Franklin asked Frances Perkins to become the first woman to serve in the U.S. cabinet, and it was she, in turn, who led the fight for Social Security, also born in conversations that took place here. The Roosevelts built close ties with Hunter College, where Eleanor would spend time with students and speak at special events. FDR himself inaugurated our Park Avenue building up the street, which was built with WPA funds. And it was Hunter College that served as the first home of the United Nations, the institution key to the Roosevelts' grand vision. After Mother Sarah died in 1941, the Roosevelts worked out a deal to turn over their home to Hunter, which Eleanor dedicated and reopened in 1943. For many years, Roosevelt House served as a site for social gatherings and weddings, but it eventually fell into disrepair. Thanks to the visionary leadership and extraordinary perseverance of Hunter President Jennifer Rabb, however, the house underwent a meticulous restoration, and in spring 2010 was relaunched as Hunter's new Public Policy Institute, housing both our public policy and human rights programs. Through these twin academic units, Roosevelt House provides innovative interdisciplinary curricular initiatives for our students and also supports opportunities for collaboration and research for our faculty. One key aspect of our new mission is to engage in productive dialogue around critical issues so that we might challenge the coarseness that has overtaken too many a public conversation and so that we might find the common and common sense solutions to our urgent problems and make the world better for our students and the future that they represent. It is therefore a particular honor to introduce our guest this evening, for there are few in public service who better represent this mission in word and deed than Senator Mitchell. With dignity and grace, our guest's distinguished career has taken him from a federal judgeship in Maine to the halls of Congress, where he rose to become Majority Leader of the Upper Chamber. But while others found countless ways of tearing opponents apart and bringing each other down in the process, Senator Mitchell was focused on ways of working together and building everyone up. His unique contributions in this regard eventually led to peace-building roles in Northern Ireland and the Middle East, and his willingness to throw himself into seemingly intractable situations made him the perfect negotiator. This sobriquet truly embodies the problem-solving and tenacity that have marked our guest's career, and so is the apt title of Senator Mitchell's new memoir, which he is here to discuss. The book is filled with interesting and telling anecdotes, and one in particular seems an especially fitting way to invite our guest to the podium. Senator Mitchell writes of his first encounter with Bowdoin College, now his alma mater, of his gratitude for his ability to work a number of part-time jobs that allowed him to work his way through college. This is an opportunity lost, alas, to too many today, as college costs continue to soar and students across the country are buried under mountains of debt. But Hunter College is proud to still offer an affordable education to our thousands of working students who graduate today with some of the lowest debt nationwide. On this note, we are so pleased, ladies and gentlemen, to have all of you here with us this evening, and we invite you to join us upstairs after the talk for a book signing and reception. But now, without further ado, please join me in welcoming Senator George Mitchell.
Well, thank you very much, Professor Bhagavan, for that extremely generous introduction. My thanks to Hunter College, to President Rabb, and to all of you, ladies and gentlemen, for taking the time to be here this evening. For me, being from Maine, where Franklin Roosevelt had another home. Actually, it's not in Maine, but you have to drive through Maine to get there. It's on the island of Campobello, which is just off the coast of Maine. There is now a international park there, jointly owned and controlled by the United States and Canada. And it resonates with me personally because as a young man and a member of the staff of Senator Edmund Muskie, I worked on the legislation which resulted in the creation of the International Commission and the acquisition and transferring the home into public ownership. And so it's very moving for me to be both now in the home of Franklin Roosevelt and to have been for a long time, and I served on the board of that park for many years, affiliated with his summer home in Maine. You mentioned Francis Perkins, who also had a home in Maine. There is now a Francis Perkins memorial at her home there. She was indeed a truly influential figure with both President Roosevelt and ultimately with the people of this country. So I kind of feel at home here, a guy from Maine in the middle of Manhattan talking about Maine. That was a really generous introduction, and I want to comment on that. I do speak often. I've talked every day this week at least a couple of times. And as a result, having heard myself speak so much, for me, the highlight of the program is the introduction. I want to thank Professor Bhagavan for living up to the high standards which I've come to expect of such introductions. But it's a dangerous thing to one's mental health to hear that stuff several times a day because you might get tempted to believe some of it. So I like to begin with a story about introductions and how I was brought back down to earth. I spent 5 years working on the peace process in Northern Ireland. I chaired three separate sets of negotiations. And when I finished, I returned home, I wrote a book. When it was published, as I'm doing now, I traveled the country attending events like this, promoting sales of the book. In the process, I received many invitations. And I was surprised to learn that in the United States, there are more Irish American organizations than there are Irish Americans. And I got invitations from all of them. I couldn't accept them all, but I did many. And I traveled the country attending these events sponsored by Irish American clubs. There developed among them an informal competition as to who could give the longest, often most fantastic, sometimes ridiculous introductions of me. The proper response, of course, would have been to show some humility, to encourage them to keep it short, but I had an improper reaction. I loved it. I encouraged them. I scolded them when they left something out. One guy spent 35 minutes detailing every event in my life, including many with which I had previously not been familiar. And when he finished, I get up and I criticized him for leaving out the fact that in my junior year at Waterville High School in Maine, I got the science award. Needless to say, the next stop, it was included in the introduction. Well, the last stop was in Stamford, Connecticut, not far from here, the Stamford, Connecticut Irish American Society. And by the time I got there, I was overly impressed with myself. I had a difficult time squeezing my head through the front door. When I did, the first person I encountered was an elderly woman who rushed up to me, very nervous, very excited, almost bowled me over, shook my hand vigorously, and she said, I don't live anywhere near here. I've driven 3 hours across the entire state of Connecticut to come here just because I want to shake your hand, to tell you what a great man you are, and to ask you, please, would you sign my poster? And she handed me a poster with a photograph on it and a pen. I looked at it. I said, I'm happy to sign your poster, but before I do, I think there's something I should tell you. She said, what is it? I said, I'm not Henry Kissinger. She was astonished and angry. She said, you're not? She said, well, who are you anyway? And when I told her, she said, "Why, that's just terrible." She said, I drove 3 hours to meet a great man named Kissinger, and all I've got is a nobody like you." I said, "Well, I'm sorry you feel so bad. I wish there's something I could do to make you feel better." And she thought for a moment, and then she kind of leaned forward. I leaned forward. Our foreheads were nearly touching. And she whispered, "Nobody will ever know the difference." She said, "Would you mind signing Henry Kissinger's name to my poster?" So I did. And it hangs today on a living room wall in Eastern Connecticut, a daily reminder to me not to get too taken away by these generous introductions. But thank you anyway. Thank you, Menu. Well, in the Senate, there is the rule of unlimited debate. So any senator can stand up at any time, speak as long as he or she wants on any subject, even though unrelated to the business being debated. As a majority leader, I listened to several 12-hour speeches, 10-hour, 8-hour speeches. And in the process, I acquired the dubious ability to be able to speak at indefinite length on any subject with no prior notice, usually neither possessing nor conveying any knowledge. But I can take up time like nobody you've ever seen. I promise not to do that this evening. I'm going to speak fairly briefly, tell a few stories about my book, and then I'll take questions from you. And as you think about your questions, if anyone would like to give a speech of their own at the end, I'm happy to listen. I entered the Senate under unusual circumstances. I was serving as a federal judge in Maine when Secretary of State Cyrus Vance resigned from office in protest against the decision by President Carter to launch a military mission to try to rescue the American hostages in Iran. The president then appointed Senator Muskie, a senator from Maine, to be Secretary of State, thereby creating a vacancy. Of course, there was a lot of speculation in Maine. I had been appointed a federal judge just the previous year, so my name was not included in the speculation. And the governor announced that he was going to move quickly and that he was going to hold a press conference the following Monday noon at the state capitol in Maine to announce his choice. On Sunday evening, I went to bed early. In Maine, we go to bed early. And wondering what the governor was going to do the next day, about 11 o'clock that night, the phone rang and it woke me up. It was the governor calling. He said, "I'd like you to come down the Capitol tomorrow noon so that I can announce I'm going to appoint you to the Senate." I said, "Governor, this is a surprise. This is a big, tough decision." I said, "I got to think about it. I got to call my family and get some advice." He said, "I'll give you 1 hour." I protested, but he said, "That's it. Call me by midnight." So I immediately called my three older brothers. I grew up, as I said, in a small town in Maine. My three older brothers were very prominent and famous athletes, not just in our community, but across the state and all of New England. And then I came along, and I was not as good an athlete as my brothers. In fact, I was not as good as anybody else's brother. And very early in life, I became known as Johnny Mitchell's kid brother, the one who isn't any good. As you might expect, I developed a massive inferiority complex and a highly competitive attitude toward my brothers. And so when I called them that night, ostensibly to seek their advice, I confess that there was a note of triumphalism in my voice. When I said to them, "Guys, the governor just called. He wants to appoint me to the U.S. Senate. What do you think about that?" My brother Johnny's response was immediate and negative. He said, "Don't do it." He said, "You're a born loser. Nobody can understand how you even got to be a federal judge. You couldn't possibly win a statewide election. Tell him no." My two other brothers said the same thing in much less polite language. So I hung up. I called the governor. I said, "Governor, I don't need an hour because I've already received all the reassurance I need of my ability to perform this job. And I accept it." I went down to the state capitol the next day. The governor made the announcement. I flew to Washington. It was on a Monday afternoon. The swearing in was scheduled to be held Tuesday morning. When I landed at the National Airport in Washington, I didn't have anything to do that night. This had all happened so quickly. So on a whim, when I got into a taxi, instead of going to the hotel where I was staying, I said to the driver, take me to the Capitol. I'm going to go to the Senate, and I thought I'll go and meet the majority leader and get the lay of the land. I went up. I was taken in. The Senate was in session, debating a bill. And I was taken down to the well of the Senate where I was introduced to the majority leader. He was very busy, confused. He had a vague notion of who I was. And he said, well, you're here, okay, we'll swear you in right now. I protested. On the way down, I'd fantasized. I wondered whether all three networks would carry my swearing in live or only one or two. And I wanted this big ceremony the next day. He said to me in a very condescending way, he said, young man, we're busy around here, and if I say we're going to swear you in, we're going to swear you in right now. Okay, I said. So he swore me in. It took about 10 seconds, very disillusioning. Nobody even noticed it, even senators who were 6 feet away. And then the Senate resumed the debate, and almost immediately a vote occurred. For those of you interested in political trivia, I hold the all-time record in American history for having cast the vote the shortest time after entering the Senate. 2 minutes. That was the first of many informed judgments I made in your behalf and in behalf of other Americans. Well, then I got sworn in, and things went from there. There are a lot of other stories I can tell about that, which I may later, but that leads me to one final comment before I say a few serious words. I'm often asked, what's the high point of my political life? People think about legislation, about becoming majority leader, Northern Ireland, stuff like that. I tell them the high point of my life occurred on the evening of November 4th, 1982. My interim term was up. I was seeking election in my own right. I was way behind in the polls. I was very lucky to come back and win the election. And on election night, the typical scene, a hotel lobby, ballroom, a big podium, a stage, a whole battery of microphones. And as I came out to give my acceptance speech, there standing on the podium, having shoved my wife and daughter out of the way, was my brother Johnny. And when I got to the microphone, he draped himself over me. He said he likes the cameras. And as I gave my acceptance speech, he was literally hanging on to me. And the next day, the Portland paper had on the front page a big picture under which the caption read, Senator George Mitchell celebrating his landslide upset election victory being cheered on by an unidentified supporter. And that was the high point of my political life. Right. Now, let me say just a few serious words about the book before I take your questions. I wrote it really for two reasons. One, like most human beings, I have been the beneficiary of help by many people and influenced by many, none more than my parents. My mother was an immigrant from Lebanon. She came here as a teenager. She spent a half century, 50 years, working the night shift in textile mills. She couldn't read or write, but she was the most influential person in my life. My father was the orphan son of Irish immigrants. He never knew his parents. He was raised in an orphanage in Boston, where he stayed for several years before he was adopted by an elderly, childless couple in Maine, who ended up having to live right next door to where my mother was living with her sister, who had preceded her as an immigrant to this country. My parents had no wealth or status. They didn't own a car. We lived in what you might think of now as a slum, most people being workers in a nearby factory. But they had a dream. And the dream was that their children would get an education that they never had and lead lives better than theirs. And although they died penniless, they were, in their minds, successful because their dream was achieved. Each of their children went to college. Some of us have advanced degrees. And each of us has lived a life that would have been completely beyond the imagination of my parents. And so I wanted to tell that story because I felt strongly that they didn't achieve any recognition in their lives, and I wanted to give it to them now. But secondly, for a broader reason, I don't think that a young boy living today in the circumstances which I lived early in my life has as much chance as I did toward upward mobility. America has changed dramatically in the years of my life, almost all of it for the better. But in this respect, I think it has regressed. America stands to me for freedom and opportunity. Opportunity for every member of society. I believe we are a country in which no one should be guaranteed success, but every single person should have a fair chance to succeed. And that means that, as we've learned through the miracle of modern science, what happens in the earliest months and days of every human being's life can have a decisive effect on that person's capacity for growth and actual development. And we haven't done a good job at making sure that every child has good care, good health, good nutrition, good early intellectual stimulation, and good education through life. And we haven't kept up with the positive effects of the technological and information revolution through which we and the rest of the world are now passing. I believe that future historians will judge this revolution to be as influential in human affairs as was the Industrial Revolution. And it's changing social and cultural patterns in a way that are hard even to catch up with and describe, let alone meet. But one thing seems to me clear, this is a personal opinion, and I'm certain there are many who disagree, that in our country, the middle class is being hollowed out. That what I call middle class, middle income, working class jobs are going, and we haven't figured out a way to replace them. Men and women need work, not just for the income that it provides, but even more importantly, for the self-esteem that's necessary for a person to live a full and meaningful life and feel like a participating, contributing member of society. Dignity is necessary above all. Franklin Roosevelt and Francis Perkins' great accomplishment, among many others, was the creation of Social Security. I can remember, I'm old enough, and I think there are a few other people who remember, but before then, before the Social Security system was enacted, only one out of every 100 Americans had any provision whatsoever for their retirement. In the small town of Waterville, Maine, there was something called the Poor Farm. Just over the last hill out of town and therefore out of sight, where men and women who'd worked out their lives and their bodies in the factories went to die in misery, in poverty, and most importantly, with a total lack of dignity and self-esteem. I think that's critical to any human life, and certainly any successful human life. And I think in our society, we have to do more and better to transfer the aspiration of opportunity for all to make it the reality. One of the reasons I enjoyed speaking at Hunter College's graduation ceremonies this year is because Hunter really is a reflection of that. A very diverse student body, many of whom are working, many of whom come from difficult backgrounds, opening a pathway to success for them. And it's not a zero-sum game. We aren't just helping individuals when we help them, we're helping the society. We all benefit when a member of our society makes a contribution that encourages economic growth, encourages job creation, encourages improvement in everyone's life. So that's one of the messages. I wrote the book to give myself a platform to discuss that, and I'm glad to have done so tonight. Now, I want to mention Hunter in one other respect. I started this tour in an event at another college here in New York, and the person who came and introduced me was Colin McCann, who's very familiar here. He's a member of the faculty and an active participant at Hunter College, and he's a distinguished author. As we started up the steps of the stage, he said to me, "What portion of your book are you going to read tonight?" I said, "Well, I don't know. I've written five books. I've never read a portion of a book before." "Oh," he said, "real authors read sections of their book." I said, "Well, I want to be a real author." So that night I read a section of the book. And whether it had any effect on the audience, it had a big effect on me. So I'd like to close by taking one of these books and reading just a brief excerpt because it makes me feel good to do so. I described earlier my parents, and the closing lines of my book are about them, as I tell two stories, one about each, that remind me of them, make me laugh, and basically indicate what they meant to me. I don't want to read it too long, but these are two stories, one about my father's heritage, Irish, one about my mother's heritage. Take just a few minutes. On a recent flight across the Atlantic, I saw the sun rising in Dublin as the plane touched down. I was drowsy, but my mind was awake with thoughts, dreams, and fantasies about those whose blood is now mine. I thought of stories of Ireland and Lebanon that always make me smile when they come to mind. I was at a reception in my honor at a resort hotel just below the border between Northern Ireland and Ireland. A bridge between them had been destroyed during the Troubles. It had been rebuilt and was now to be called the Peace Bridge and named after me. The large and friendly crowd of well-wishers peppered me with questions about my father and his family. Most reacted with surprise and disbelief when I answered that I really didn't know much about his family history. To them, history is a living part of the present. A couple of them suggested then that I retain them, both in the business that specializes in genealogy, mostly for wealthy Irish Americans. And with a twinkle in his eye and a sly smile on his face, the host of the event, who was a local official, said to me, "Senator, if you pay them enough, they'll connect you to Brian Boru." Now, Brian Boru was an ancient warrior king, well known in Ireland, sort of roughly the equivalent of George Washington to Americans. So it'd be like connecting each of us to George Washington by birth. So we all laughed. In other words, it's all a bunch of hokum. On the other hand, maybe it's not. The other story is about my mother. When we were growing up, she often said to her children softly and with great nostalgia, "You should see Lebanon. It's so beautiful, the air is pure, the water clear, the mountains, the forests, even the flowers smell better. Oh, Lebanon, my Lebanon." After arriving in the United States at the age of 18, she returned to Lebanon only once, very late in her life, after my father died. My sister accompanied her, and as they returned to the village where my mother grew up, they attended a reception and dinner with relatives and friends in the house in which my mother had grown up. Late in the evening, after a lot of food and drinking, my mother was asked to say something. Now think about this, a woman who had no education, couldn't read or write, probably had never given a public talk in her life. According to my sister, she stood, paused, looked at the large happy crowd and said with great emotion and a broad smile, "You should see America." "It's so beautiful. The air is pure, the mountains, forest, even the flowers smell better. Oh, America, my America." She had no formal education. She couldn't read or write English and spoke it with a heavy accent. She worked her entire adult life on the night shift in a textile mill. But she was generous and loving, strong and wise, and she understood clearly the meaning of America. To me, no one has ever said it better. Oh, America, my America. Thank you all very much. I'll be glad now to take a question on, yes, on any subject.
In all of your negotiations, I was wondering, what drove you crazy, if that ever happened to you, and what kept you up at night?
On the first day of the negotiations in Northern Ireland, I made one of the many mistakes I've made in my life. I said to the delegates of the peace talks, there were about 60 people in the room. Remember, this is a negotiation in which there were 12 parties, the government of Ireland, the government of Britain, and 10 political parties in Northern Ireland. So a lot of participants. And I said to them in a moment of arrogance and hubris, I'm a product of the U.S. Senate. We have the rule of unlimited debate. I've listened to long speeches. I can listen to anything you guys say. How I regretted that over the next several years as I listened and listened and listened and listened to mind-numbing repetition. The same guys making the same speeches on the same subject every day, arguing over the same points. It was a fatal, not fatal, it was a near fatal mistake for me, one I will never make again. And so I regretted that very much. What kept me up was trying to fight off despair. This was a very long process, years with no progress, regression. There were ceasefires that were routinely broken, bombs killing people, murder, assassinations. Two of the delegates of the talks were assassinated during the talks. And every time a tragedy like that occurred, the British government and the Irish government would call me up and say, you got to have a press conference to say how good things are going. And it was a very difficult test. I wrote another book on Northern Ireland, as I said, and I said in that book that one of the most difficult tasks I've ever had was to go to those press conferences and not make false statements, not lie. Try, however, to somehow create some glimmer of hope in what we were doing, even though it was a very difficult, desperate situation. So that really kept me up at night a great deal of the time. And until the end, I've said, used the phrase, that we had 700 days of failure and one day of success. And we really didn't know we were going to succeed until the very last minute of the very last day. The lesson I drew from it is that you can't take no for an answer. You certainly can't take the first no or the 10th no or the 50th no. You just have to keep at it. Hope that you can find common ground and hope in the end that it'll come together. In that case, it did. In the Middle East, it did not. Yes, sir.
As you know, Senator, the negotiations between the Americans and the Western powers over the Iranian nuclear question is coming to a head.
Yes.
When the Iranians violate their agreement, not if they violate the agreement, when the Iranians violate the agreement they've signed, what actions do you feel the Americans and the Western powers will take? That's first of all. And second of all, what action would America's allies take, particularly the Israelis, the Saudis, and our Gulf allies? What actions do you think they would take?
If I might put it in context and respond to your question, I believe that Iran should not and will not get a nuclear weapon. It would be a direct threat to Israel. It would also, I believe, undermine the nuclear non-proliferation effort, which the United States has led over the past several decades with considerable success. It's a good part of our democracy that we're self-critical. Sometimes we're overly self-critical, and in this area, I think we have been. We've done a pretty good job. There are dozens of countries in the world, several dozen, who have the capacity to produce nuclear weapons, who voluntarily refrain from doing so in their belief in both the United States and in the non-proliferation regime. I think Iran getting a weapon will, for a variety of historical reasons, trigger an immediate race in the Middle East, certainly Saudis, the Egyptians, the Turks, probably the Emiratis and others will develop programs. I think several of them are already laying the groundwork. So I don't think they should get a weapon. There are two ways to achieve that, through negotiation or through war. It seems to me that it makes simple, plain common sense to try to achieve it through negotiation before you resort to the devastating, what I think, last resort of war would be. That's what we're trying to do now. When the president and the Iranians announced the interim agreement in November 2013, it was immediately denounced by the president's opponents, who predicted, just as you have said, that Iran would violate that agreement. And in fact, some use the exact words you did. It's not a question of if, it's a question of when. In fact, Iran has not violated the interim agreement, as certified by the International Atomic Energy Agency. That doesn't mean they won't violate a permanent agreement. In fact, it is likely possible that they will. I don't state it in the certain terms that you do, but I acknowledge the possibility. To me, the issue is one of verification. Will this agreement provide verification procedures sufficient to justify entering into the agreement and sufficient to assure the United States and its negotiating partners that Iran will in fact comply and do what it says in the agreement it will do? And I don't know what those procedures will be because they haven't been negotiated yet. And we have to wait and see what the consequences are. The U.S. position has been very clear. The sanctions will be lifted in response to the Iranians performing the acts that they agreed to perform in the agreement. The lifting of the sanctions is not time-based, it's event-based. If the compliance occurs one day after the agreement, a portion of the sanctions will be lifted. Most of the compliance requires substantial periods of time, so it can't, in practice, occur one day. If they occur 1 year or 2 years, that's when the sanctions will be lifted. I think it's important to, however, consider not just within a limited frame the agreement itself, but the alternatives to agreement. The president's critics say the agreement is insufficient. In fact, they said that before there was an agreement. The opposition was adamant and vocal that there should be no negotiation because there can be no acceptable agreement. Their argument now, the members of Congress who oppose the president, is that we should withdraw from the negotiations, we should increase the sanctions, and Iran will come crawling back in a compatible mode. The fact of the matter is that it is indeed the sanctions that have brought Iran to the table. In combination with low oil prices, it's devastated their economy. But the sanctions are effective because they are universal. It is not just the United States sitting across the table from Iran. It's the United States, China, Russia, Britain, France, and Germany. They are all observing the sanctions regime. The Russians and the Chinese have already said that if we withdraw and we vote to increase the sanctions, they will not only not go along with the increase, they will eliminate the sanctions from their standpoint. So a decision to withdraw and increase the sanctions will have the perverse effect of eliminating the effectiveness of the sanctions because they will go from universal and effective to unilateral and ineffective. There has never been a case when unilateral sanctions, unilateral by the U.S. alone, has achieved the desired political objective for the obvious reason. If China, Russia, Britain, France, and Germany don't join in the sanctions, nobody else will. And Iran can trade with anyone that they want. So that alternative would leave the United States with two choices: accept a nuclear Iran or a war to prevent a nuclear Iran. It may come to that, but we have to take that very seriously. Every recent Secretary of Defense, Democrat and Republican, has said that the United States cannot, by airstrikes alone, guarantee the destruction of Iran's nuclear program. We can set it back. 4 years is the best estimate. But that, of course, would guarantee that Iran would ultimately redouble their efforts. And they have said the only way that the guarantee of the destruction of their program could be achieved is by a land invasion, which would involve an invading army of 1 million men. And every American ought to think seriously about the consequences of such an action. Now, I don't think they'll get a weapon, and I think that there will be conflict to prevent it if they persist. But to me, it defies common sense to say that you should not even try to negotiate, that you should not even make the effort to reach an agreement and to obtain a verifiable result. So I have made up my mind, because I don't know what the verification provisions are going to be, and my decision will be based largely on that.
Two questions.
Yeah.
The first one is, what are three top tips that you will give us to become, three top tips you can give us to become better negotiators in all the negotiations that we do in our life, right, apart from buying the book, which we will. Yeah. Second is, you come across as a happy, jovial, sunny, optimistic person. And you spoke about your mom and dad. So can you reflect a little bit back on your upbringing, which made you who you are? Thank you.
On negotiation, I think it's really, again, pretty much common sense. First, I think you have to have the clearest possible understanding of the issues and the personalities. When the president asked me to go to Northern Ireland, I had never been there. And although my father's of Irish heritage, I'd only been to Ireland once for 2 days. I had a vague general sense of it, but I immediately prepared a reading list. I read overall over the 5 years about 40 books on the history of the conflict. I went there and I made it a point to visit each of the political leaders, to meet them personally, to try to gauge them in a personal sense. I read about their backgrounds. I went back and got copies of their speeches and statements and articles about them, so to get fully informed. Secondly, patience. You really do have to have patience. You can't be a negotiator if you've got a short fuse. And you have to be willing to sit and listen to things that you think are ridiculous, but to let people have their say. I think one of the dumbest things they ever said at the outset was about listening to speeches. One of the best things they ever said to them was on the first day that, "I do not come here with an American plan. There is no Mitchell peace agreement proposal. Any agreement will be yours." And I made certain when I drafted the agreement years later that every single word was spoken or written by someone from Northern Ireland. I said, "This must be your process, because it is you who will live with the consequences, not me." And so I think that's one aspect of it. And finally, I would say genuinely listening. I'm not a scientist, so I'll speak as a layman. I believe that the receptors in our brain for information that is consistent with our prior beliefs, the receptors are wide open. We receive it well, we retain it, we use it well. But information that is inconsistent with our prior beliefs, I think it's a tiny little hole, and it doesn't get through much, and we don't hear it much, and we don't use it much. You have to really work to listen to someone you disagree with. And you really have to work if it's someone you also dislike at the same time. That's very hard to do, and especially for several years, as I did. I listened to people talking that I didn't agree with. Some of them were adamantly opposed to me, outspokenly opposed to me, but I forced myself to do it, and I think that's also critical in negotiation. With respect to my parents, I think I was influenced by them. My parents had very hard lives, but they never lost their optimism. They never lost their sense of gratitude about this country. As with many here, in this room, in this city, in this country, their whole effort was assimilation. They wanted us to become Americans. They were very proud of America. They were very proud of the fact that each of their four sons served in our military. I had two brothers who served in the Navy, one in the Marines, and I served in the Army. And I say frankly, and I said this in my book, I serving in the Army was one of the best things that ever happened to me. I felt I was doing something for my country. I learned, I grew up, I learned, reinforced the values of patriotism, teamwork, working with others. Many people don't get that opportunity. I think it's too bad. I don't think we can practically have an all-volunteer army or a mandatory service role, but there would be a huge benefit if we could. And so I think that's what they created in me, a sense of you're an American, you're as good as the next guy, and if you work hard, success will come.
I'd like to ask you about the Middle East.
Yep.
Not ISIS, let somebody else ask you about ISIS.
Yeah.
But I'd like to ask you what you think is going to happen between the Israelis and the Palestinians.
Right.
It's been so long.
Yes. It has been long, 60 years. We've had 12 presidents, 20 secretaries of state, many Israeli prime ministers, many Arab leaders, none of whom have succeeded in bringing it to a conclusion. But I retain hope and optimism that it will occur, and I believe in the reasonably close future for one simple reason. I think it is so much in the self-interest of both societies that there be an agreement for a variety of reasons, which I'll try to explore now. That I think they will come to it, because I think countries like individuals act ultimately out of self-interest. I emphasize this is a big issue. I'm actually doing another book on that, and it would take a long speech, so I'll try to do it in an abbreviated fashion, but it's hard to give a 30-second answer to a question like that, and I want to give it the seriousness it deserves. President Bush, just before he left office, went to Jerusalem on January 9th of the 11 days before he left office, and he gave a very powerful speech in which he set forth American policy. And I'll paraphrase now, but essentially what he said was that it is in the Israelis' interest that the Palestinians get a state, and it is in the Palestinians' interest that the people of Israel have reasonable and sustainable security for their people. Israel has a state, a very successful, a spectacularly successful state. I'm sure many of you have been there. Those of you who haven't, I urge you to go. It is amazing. It is inspiring. But they don't have just simple, plain, ordinary security. There is widespread fear and anxiety for the obvious reasons that they're surrounded by enemies. There are thousands of missiles directed at them that could be launched at any moment. They ought to have better than that. The United States is fully committed to Israel's security and existence behind defensible borders, and we think they should have security. The Palestinians don't have a state, and they want one. I believe, as President Bush said, the Palestinians are not going to get a state until the people of Israel have reasonable and sustainable security, and the people of Israel are not going to get reasonable and sustainable security until the Palestinians get a state. And right now, that is impossible because both societies are divided. Among the Palestinian society, there are two main factions. One is the Palestinian Authority. They have publicly committed to nonviolence. They have kept that commitment largely, particularly in the last several years. They are publicly committed to accept Israel's existence and to desire for an agreement to live in peace and security. Other half of the Palestinian society is in opposition to that. Hamas opposes Israel's existence and refuses to commit to nonviolence. So they're divided. Israeli society is divided. There's a substantial portion of the Israeli public that favors a two-state solution. There is also a substantial portion of the public that opposes it. Several ministers in the government have outspokenly said there will never be a Palestinian state on the West Bank. The prime minister, as we know, has made several statements both ways. The policy officially is that, yes, there can be one, but now is not the right time. In that circumstance, I spent much time with both Netanyahu and Abbas. In my opinion, Netanyahu does not believe that Abbas has the personal or political strength to reach an agreement or to implement an agreement. And therefore, he believes that any negotiation will fail because of Abbas. Abbas, by contrast, believes that Netanyahu is not serious about getting a Palestinian state. He cites as evidence the prime minister's statements on both sides of the question many times, and that he believes that a process will not succeed because Netanyahu will not permit it to succeed, that he says only those things needed to placate the United States. Both men, therefore, believe a process won't succeed. Both, therefore, are unwilling to make concessions which would subject them to fierce domestic political criticism for a process they don't think will ever work. Now, it may take a change in leadership, it may take a change in circumstance, but the sad history of this conflict is that over the past several decades, every time the so-called peace process stops, violence begins. And it would be a tragedy that they had to resume only as a consequence of another huge outbreak of violence in which thousands of people die and thousands are threatened. I hope that the United States will continue the effort despite the difficulty, despite the past. The two-state solution has survived despite the fact it hasn't been achieved and much criticism because no alternative has been presented which offers a more realistic prospect of success. And I'll just say both sides face serious consequences in the future. And let me take a moment to describe that. Israel is now militarily dominant in a way that could not possibly have been foreseen 60 years ago when it was created. When the United Nations offered partition as a solution, Israel accepted. The Arabs rejected it. And the first war started. There were only 600,000 Jews then living in the Yeshuv, as the Jewish community in that area was known at the time. The Arab populations totaled many tens of millions. They thought it would be an easy walkover. Israel's existence hung precariously in the balance, but they won that first war, have won every war since, and have since, with the aid of the United States, have achieved overwhelming military dominance. But they haven't been able to establish a relationship with any of their neighbors because primarily of the Palestinian issue. They can do that, and I believe they will benefit from it. Right now, look at this. You mentioned Iran. Both Israel and Saudi Arabia have identically, as their highest foreign policy priority, opposition to Iran getting a nuclear weapon. Two countries with an identical foreign policy interest living in the same region who do not cooperate in any way in achieving their objective. That's extraordinary when you think about the history of national alliances. That's because the Palestinian issue stands as a barrier between them. Secondly, from Israel's standpoint, the demographics are dangerous. Right now, the area between the Jordan River and the Mediterranean Sea, there are about 6.25 million Jews and about 5.75 million Arabs, counting Israeli Arabs, West Bank, and Gaza. The population trends are dramatic and, at this point, irreversible in the short term, and by about 2017, the Arab population will be about equal to that of the Jewish population. And as former Prime Minister and Defense Minister Ehud Barak has said many times publicly in Israel, at that point, if there is no two-state solution, Israel faces the choice it should never have to make of being either a Jewish state or a democratic state. In a one-state solution, it cannot be both when the majority of the population is Arab. The third issue is isolation. Israel's support is very, very strong in the United States, especially in the U.S. Congress, but it is deteriorating everywhere else in the world. When I was the envoy in the Middle East, I spent one-third of my time meeting with American allies, trying to persuade them to support our support of Israel, trying to keep them in line so we would have a unified position among the Western countries in support of Israel. Everybody here has read the papers in the last 6 months. The Vatican, the French Parliament, the Swedish government, the British Parliament. The movement is entirely in the opposite direction in support of the Palestinian position with respect to statehood. And I think it's important that that issue be lanced. Take the long-term political projections. Right now, there are 7.5 billion people in the world. 1 in 5 is Muslim, about 1.5 billion. By 2060, according to the United Nations projections, the population will be between 9.5 and 10 billion. At that point, 1 in 3 will be Muslim. There'll be 3.5 billion Muslims in the world by the middle of this century. That was the total population of the world as recently as 1970. The Arabs comprise, of course, only about a third of the Muslim population, now about 400 million. But in that interim, is the Israeli population of Jews will increase from 6 million to 8 million, and the Arab population will go from 400 million to anywhere between 600 and 800 million. And the disproportionate numbers increase dramatically thereafter. So I think it's in Israel's interest to act now, while they're strong, while they're dominant, and solve this issue as they did with Egypt, as they did with Jordan. And it can be done here. And I think that would lead to a normalization of relations with many of the neighbors who have come to understand that, first, Israel's here to stay, and second, the real enemy is across the Persian Gulf. It's not Israel. When I talk to the leaders in those countries, they always bring up Iran. Many of them, the first thing they bring up is Iran. So I think it's in both their interests, and I think the United States should, because it's in our interest, to keep the effort going despite the setbacks, despite the difficulties, despite the failures. And I hope that this president continues and the next president does so as well. I'm getting the signal. One more question. Do I get one woman here? Right.
Thank you very much. Comment on Putin the man and Putin the negotiator.
Yeah. I think Putin is obviously a skillful individual and negotiator, but I think his country is going to have a hard time. They've suffered enormous national humiliation, going from being one of two superpowers to a lesser status. It's understandable. In the Second World War, 63 million people died. 20 million of them were Russians. They lost 10 times more people in that one war than the United States has lost in all the wars in our history. And for them, this outcome is sort of like, we won the war, but what happened? We lost the peace. And so they're going through a period of national humiliation that will continue. When Putin took office, he said on the very first day, his greatest fear was that Russia, for the first time in 300 years, faced the prospect of declining into what he said was the second or third rank of nations. And I think that's likely to occur inevitably, notwithstanding his efforts. Russia's national budget derives about 55% of its revenues from a direct tax on oil and gas. The break-even point for their national budget is oil at $110 a barrel. There is not an expert in the world that I'm aware of who thinks that oil is going to be anywhere near $10 a barrel anytime in the foreseeable future. So they face a terrific problem of financial stress. Secondly, population. The United States population is going from the current 315 million to 440 million by 2050. The Russian population is in a steady decline. Worse for them, the composition of the population is changing. It's now 20% Muslim, but as the Slavic population continues to decrease, the Muslim population is increasing. Putin said, we want a referendum in Crimea. You will never hear him stand up and say, we want a referendum in Chechnya or in Dagestan or in some of the other Muslim-majority areas. So they face very difficult problems to remain at the top rank of nations. They will do so for some time because they possess a massive nuclear arsenal. And that's something that ought to be considered. But I think we have to be steady and strong. I think we can't take the bait and respond to every comment that's made about the United States. We are the dominant power. We have achieved a military dominance that is unprecedented in human history. I'll just say this is a digression. It's common for people to say, now the world's falling apart and it's more dangerous than ever. I don't think the world's falling apart. The falling apart is being better reported, but it's always been there. And secondly, it's not more dangerous than ever. In the 20th century, in just the two world wars, 78 million people died in a world in which the population was about a third of what it is today. The per capita equivalent would be 250 million people dying now. Well, it's tragic. Every death is tragic, and to the families involved, of course, it's horrific. But the numbers of deaths now are minuscule compared to the conflicts of the First and Second World War and the rest of the century. I don't think we're likely to see a Third World War because the United States is so dominant, there is no one to challenge us. And I hope that continues. I think it's an important role of stability that we play in the world. So I think Putin will do well. I don't think the Russian people will. Thank you all very much.